pitch I'm presenting as a 74-year-old male. He originally came in with complaints of itchy, watery eyes while he was in Island Park, and he was having trouble with his vision while he was fly fishing. Came in, had a history of meibomian gland dysfunction, was having some dry eyes, was noted to have bilateral nasal pterygium. He denied any chemical or thermal burns to his eyes. He was started on artificial tears, given a new prescription, and as follow-up occurred, you can see there's several things here. His redness and tearing was initially stable, his vision was doing good, but he started developing pterygium both inferiorly, and then at his last appointment before being referred to Dr. Zog, he was starting to have some conjunctivitis inferiorly in bilateral eyes. When he presented to Dr. Zog, he also had a nasal pterygium. Here's his exam. His visual acuity was preserved. His pupillary reflex was still intact. And the conjunctivitis was noted inferiorly bilaterally. He had some cataracts. These are images taken from that first appointment with Dr. Zog. These two stacked closer to me are his right eye, and these two on the far side are his left eye. You can see the pterygium pretty well there, and inferiorly you can kind of start to see some conjunctivitis and neovascularization. So he was diagnosed based on his clinical signs and symptoms with limbal stem cell deficiency. So I wanted to review a little bit of limbal stem cell deficiency, go over some of the key studies, or at least some of the interesting studies that I found that help localize the corneal stem cells to the limbus, and a few other anatomical landmarks that are important both diagnostically and with the pathophysiology. So one of the earliest studies I was able to find was in 1942 by Ma and Pullinger. They were studying the effects of mustard gas on the cornea of rabbits. The first thing that they noticed was that there was a dose-dependent relationship between the amount of exposure to mustard gas and damage to the rabbit's cornea. They also noticed that with that damage, they would get migration of melanin pigment more centrally onto the cornea. And then in 1971 is when their first paper was published for Davenger and Evanson. They were studying guinea pigs, later went on to study humanized as well. But a couple of very interesting things that they noticed is they would remove areas of the corneal epithelium just central to the limbal ring in the guinea pigs and then watch them. And within the first 24 hours, they would notice that, and the limbal ring exactly adjacent to their corneal erosion, that it was slightly lighter in pigmentation, and then they found pigment overlying those corneal erosions. And then following those guinea pigs, after 5 days, they would see complete resolution of the pigment that they found over the cornea, and then a return of the color, the appropriate color in the limbal ring. They also noticed that within those first 24 hours, they found an increased rate of arrested cells of mitosis. And so that was interesting. Then in the early 80s, Thoft and Friend, they came up with the XYZ hypothesis, which is kind of what this picture on the far side depicts a little bit, although not perfectly anatomically correct. But I appreciated the different views in correlating with the views of the cornea. So their thought was the stem cells in the limbus represented by X were dividing and multiplying, and then as they continue to divide and differentiate and migrate superiorly or superficially and vertically, they would continue to divide. That's why those are the transient amplifying cells. And both the sum of both of those divisions would equal Z, or the amount of corneal, mature corneal epithelial cells that were lost and sloughing off in the tear film. Their hypothesis was later confirmed in 89 by Sharma. And then Cotsarellis in 89 also had an experiment that I thought was very interesting. They used a tritiated thymidine to label the cells in the cornea. And they noticed a region in the limbus that the cells were very quiescent, but they would increase their mitotic rate after injury to the cornea. And then the palisades of Vogt, this is an anatomical structure. They're papilla-like structures in the limbus with densely packed basal cells at the bottom of the papillae, surrounded with connective tissue, a good blood supply, and nerves. Of the basal cells in the palisades of Vogt, they think about 10 to 15% are maybe stem cells. And the most concentrated area of palisades of Vogt are in the superior and inferior limbus, more so than the horizontal meridians. And then interesting, the cornea obviously plays a very important function as a barrier. And the corneal epithelium specifically has tight junctions that help make up that barrier, which are lost in limbal stem cell deficiency, which kind of helps potentiate the inflammatory cycle of limbal stem cell deficiency as the tear film breaks down, increased permeability to leukocytes and other white blood cells in the corneal stroma. So I have a couple slides on the etiologies, not necessarily listed in order of most common, but idiopathic, obviously, probably one of the most common is chemical or thermal burns, especially alkali, so cement, mortar, things like that, acidic burns from cleaners, drain cleaners, car batteries. It can also be iatrogenic, from ocular surgery, contact use, radiotherapy. The autoimmune causes I found to be very interesting. They have the highest rate of transplant rejection, with obviously there being systemic diseases, so it's hard to control the inflammatory response, which is pro-apoptotic on the limbal stem cells. Steven Johnson syndrome specifically seems to affect the lids more so, destroys the meibomian glands and some of the other accessory glands, which can lead to severe dry eye and then corneal keratinization. Ocular cicatricial pemphigoid, usually found in women over 50. I think the average age of diagnosis was around 65. Commonly seen with symblepharon and shortening of the fornix. Important for both of those, I guess, diagnostically, really quick before I forget, they can have a complete absence of goblet cells, which when we talk here in a second about some of the methods that are used to confirm the diagnosis of limbal stem cell deficiency, that can create some difficulty. There's a whole list of eye diseases there that you can see. One unifying factor in that list, under number five, is kind of the effect of the inflammation and then knocking out limbal stem cells. Congenital causes, aniridia is probably one of the most common. I thought it was interesting that it spans the whole gamut of aniridia. You can still get limbal stem cell deficiency, both from complete absence of the iris or to just mild struggle, hypoplasia. About 90% of people with aniridia will have this keratopathy. It's been linked with a PAC6 deficiency. PAC6, they've shown, is important for the upregulation, or is upregulated when the cornea is injured, and further downstream will upregulate things like cytokeratin 12 and MMP9, a few cell adhesion molecules, which are all, I mean, in summary, kind of all very important for corneal health. So moving to some clinical signs and symptoms, there's obviously pain, tearing, photophobia, corneal neovascularization, conjunctival ingrowth is probably the most reliable, or considered the most reliable sign of disease clinically. You can also see with topical fluorescein some wave-like irregularity, kind of in a vortex pattern on the cortex, and increased epithelial permeability, kind of like I mentioned, with the loss of those tight junctions, and you can see the stromal body light up a little bit more. Here's a picture of that, and you can see the wave-like abnormality there. Like I mentioned with our patient, if it's kind of classic and with clinical signs and symptoms, that is enough to establish the diagnosis. If you're looking to confirm it, one of the other more conventional techniques is impression cytology. The goal with impression cytology is to identify goblet cells or mucin. Use a cellulose acetate paper, put it on the cornea, dry, and then use a periodic acid shift stain, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. You look for the goblet cells, or like you're seeing here, mucin aggregates in pink. Has a really good ability to identify disease and confirm the disease, but a negative result with impression cytology, not necessarily rule out the disease. As I mentioned, there can be an absence of goblet cells early on in disease or late on disease, like in those autoimmune conditions, there can be a complete absence of goblet cells as well. So if people have been looking into several different diagnostic techniques to try and confirm this disease, so they've used in vivo confocal microscopy, OCT. These are confocal images here with the three columns by A are from the central cornea, and the two columns by B are from the limbus. That far corner picture is a normal cornea, and those are the palisades of Vogt. You can see as disease progresses, a lot of these anatomical landmarks are lost or destroyed in both locations. The confocal microscopy, they found a 90% concordance rate with impression cytology. Has some limitations. Obviously, it's expensive equipment. Takes a lot of technical expertise to use it. A very cooperative patient, as it does require contact with the cornea. OCT, if you have a high resolution OCT with an actual resolution of like 3 millimeters, you can diagnose or identify some of these anatomical landmarks. The papers that I was able to find, they haven't shown any diagnostic evidence of OCT for this disease, but they're theorizing that it could be helpful as you can identify a lot of those landmarks. Histological markers have been used or being used and studied in concordance with impression cytology. So cytokeratin 3 is found in the cornea and 19 on the conjunctiva. More recently, they've found cytokeratin 7 and 13, a little bit more specific for the conjunctiva. So when they've done studies and looked at using both together with impression cytology alone, they found goblet cells in like 56% of samples, and using cytokeratin 3 and 19, that jumped up to around 86%. So increase the catch there a little bit. And then MUC5AC is just goblet cells secreting mucin. Or a way to identify that. It has some of the same problems. It can increase the catch. I think that was even more dramatic, from like 30% or so up to 89%, or no, 94%. The problem with these is the specificity and getting more specific markers. So moving to management really quick, if it's mild or focal, you can just focus on controlling inflammation, removing any inciting factors, topical steroids or stasis. If it's kind of sectoral or mild, you can do debridement or abnormal of the abnormal epithelium. More extensive disease, so if it's unilateral diffuse, you can use this conjunctival lipid autografting technique. These are kind of out of order, but more recent techniques, the simple limbal epithelial transplantation. I think the first paper was in 2011, in the culture of limbal epithelial transplantation. The benefit with those, if you're using autografts, is you don't have to use systemic immunosuppression. If the disease is bilateral diffuse, though, living relative allografts or donor cadaveric donor allografts are possible, and they have had a really good success when they use systemic immunosuppression. These are some diagrams that I thought were interesting, really helped me visualize the surgical process. So these ones on the left is the conjunctival limbal autograft, and the living relative autograft is kind of the same process, just where you're getting your donor sites from. You take the donor sites from the superficial, or the superior inferior meridians. They're kind of like we talked to the most dense location of the palisades of Vogt. Do the 360 keratomy and superficial keratectomy. Sew in your grafts. Kind of similar with the one on the far side is the keratolimbal allograft, and then in the middle, I guess I forgot to mention, there's the Cincinnati procedure, which kind of combines the conjunctival limbal allograft and the keratolimbal allograft. I was able to see, although not on our patient with Dr. Zog, a simple limbal epithelial transplant. One of the benefits with that specific surgery is you can take less donor sites. So instead of taking 2 and A on this close side, you can just take one sample, pretty much complete the rest of the steps the same. And then instead of D, You cut that sample into 8 to 10 pieces, arrange it around the cornea while avoiding the central visual axis, and place amniotic membranes below and above to kind of help protect the cornea and give a lot of growth factors there. One of the benefits, I don't have a good picture here of the culture transplantation, but compared to these, you get a full, a complete coverage of the cornea and the limbus, which is one of the benefits. And we're kind of studying it. So kind of returning, returning to our patient, when he followed up in Dr. Zog's clinic, he was stable, doing well, no further progression of the disease, so we just continued the current treatment plan. These are some of my references. And any questions? All right, thanks.